Dear sisters and brothers, you know, Prophet of Islam used to pray almost on a daily basis that all human beings are sisters and brothers to one another. So this should be our culture as well. So dear sisters and brothers from Germany, a very good evening and a very warm welcome to all of you. I'm very happy to meet all of you once again. So my topic is status of women in Islam. So before I discuss and provide some examples in this regard, I'll say first of all we will have to understand the difference between Islam and Muslim culture. So there are so many things that Muslim women feel they are restricted in many matters. They are not given opportunities. They have to remain indoors. They have to wear headscarf. So all these things are part of culture. This is not Islam. You know, Islam came in medieval world, and in the medieval world, the ancient culture prevailed, and in those times, there were very few opportunities outdoors. Women lived indoors and the outside world was not safe for women, and there are no opportunities. They had to live indoors, and whenever they went out, they used long flowing garments. That was actually understood as a symbol of respectability. So usually they didn't go out, they had to remain indoors. Only some royal families, the women who belonged to royal families, they had some opportunities. So it was a male dominated society since ancient times, till it lasted till medieval times, and religion was also male dominated. So it was this thing which reflects upon the perception of Muslim women today, and because they have been under that culture for at least 1400 years, so that culture, that ancient culture, was Islamized. They think that this is Islam. They are not very clear about it, that this is not Islam, this is culture which has been Islamized. So I'll give some examples of from the Quran, some verses from the Quran, some examples from the life of the Prophet, some examples from the wives of the companions of the Prophet, and the wife of the Prophet, so that it becomes clear that the women in those times, the early phase, which is regarded as the ideal phase, so they were very free. They could do anything. They did business, they went inside the mosque, they did everything. They went outdoors, they looked after their orchard. So, and that was according to the teachings of Islam, teachings of the Quran. There is a verse in the Quran in chapter 3, you are members one of another. At another place it says, it is He who created you from a single soul. So men and women are equal according to the teachings of the Quran. So the same teaching we find in Hadith, which are sayings of the Prophet. The Prophet said, men and women are two equal halves of a single unit. So they are just equal, just as men are. There is no difference, no discrimination against women in Islam. And this we find in the practice of the Prophet and his companions, and in the early ideal phase of Islam. So Prophet gave full freedom to women. Prophet was married to Khadija before he received prophethood. So Khadija conducted business. Though the Prophet did not object to this business activities, And after he received prophethood, even then he did not object to it. She continued to do business. So that showed that women can engage in business activities. Then we have another example of religious freedom. In the most sacred mosques of Medina, Masjid-e-Nabawi, all women used to go for prayer in not only individually but also in congregation. There was no restriction. So the Prophet encouraged them to participate in these religious activities. And sometimes they would come with their small babies. There was no one at home to look after the babies. So they would come with them and the babies would start crying during prayer. The Prophet did not say that you shouldn't come to the mosque because the babies are disturbing our prayer. The Prophet himself shortened his prayer. So this happened. To this extent, the Prophet wanted them to engage in all religious activities like men. Then Prophet's wife Aisha was a very intelligent and had a very good photographic memory. So Prophet trained her and gave her good religious education, discussed every matter with her. Whenever he went out, he took her and other wives also with him, so that to give proper training, because in those days there was very less education. So it was these ladies who were responsible for giving primary education to all the children, because in those days there were no schools like we have today. So these ladies who were educated by the Prophet, so they would open schools in their homes and give education to the children. And when the children grew up, then they could go to far off places, because the schools were not in every locality as we find today. So Aisha has a great contribution in the field of fiqh, in the field of tafsir, and in the field of traditions. She used to explain the reason and the wisdom behind the teachings of the Prophet. There were so many things, so many aspects which were not clear to the senior companions of the Prophet. So they would come to Aisha to explain these things. So, and she would explain to their satisfaction. Then we have that example of freedom of expression. There was one lady called Barira. She was married to Mughis. Mughis was black and Barira was fair, so she didn't like Mughis. So she went to the Prophet to seek separation. The Prophet heard the case, and then the Prophet advised that you should stay with this marriage and adjust with your husband. So, but she asked, is it your personal advice or is it the command of God? So the Prophet said that this is my personal advice. Then Barira said, then I don't need it. So Prophet did not mind, Prophet did not object to it, that I am a prophet, I'm giving you advice and you're saying I don't need it. And finally she got separation and the Prophet did not say anything. So women had full freedom in every matter, in every field. They were active in every field. So they also had legal rights. Women usually did not have legal rights in those days, because it was considered that women are weak of judgment, so they can't manage property. But the Quran has this to say: women shall have a share in what their parents and kinsmen leave, whether it be little or much, it is legally theirs. This is chapter 4, verse 7. So I'll be very brief. There is another example of getting a job in those times when there were very few opportunities, but still those opportunities were open to ladies. You know, during Caliph Umar, who was the second Caliph of Islam, So there was one lady, Shifa. So she was appointed as a supervisor of the market of Medina. Matlab, Hazrat Umar, who was so difficult to deal with, people were afraid of him. He got angry very soon, and he appointed a woman. He must have seen capability in that lady, and he appointed her to supervise the market of Medina. So this showed that she can also get a job outside home and can do it very successfully. Then there are examples of women being granted greater honor than men. There are many, many traditions in this regard. There is one tradition, Prophet observed, heaven lies beneath the feet of mothers. Then there is another, that means that if you serve your mothers, then heaven will be reserved for you. There is another tradition, once a person came to the Prophet and said, who rightfully deserves the best treatment from me? The Prophet said, your mother. Then he again asked, who next? Then the Prophet said, your mother. The third time also said, your mother. It is the fourth time he said, your father. So that women are granted more honor and more dignity than even men. I think it was because to emphasize the role of women in society, and because she was, in those times, she did not have her role, her honor, her respect. So the Prophet emphasized it more. Then the best thing that we have is that women have equal reward in the hereafter. So they are equal in respect of worldly honor, and they are equal in respect of the honor in the hereafter. There is a verse in the Quran, chapter 40, verse 20. Those that have faith and do good works, both men and women, shall enter the garden of paradise and receive blessings without measure. So I think this is the ultimate statement of equality. With this, I would like to conclude my message. Thank you very much once again.